told now that they're not going to do the new road while they're waiting for the reports of consultants, etc., on the so-called golf resorts. But first, I don't think that will happen, by the way, but I hope it won't, but that's another matter. Now, as regards the way into the bottom end of Cllr Road, I've discussed this recently again with traffic officers, and they do agree that it needs to be clearly marked in that way, and they are in the process now of making arrangements to have that made into a one-way system, which it is at the moment, but people don't recognise it. We did have the same problem at the bottom of Bridge Road in the other end of our ward in West Kerry, and we got no big signs put on the road saying no entry in the park, which we didn't want people to accidentally turn into, and that's helped considerably. I think in the very near future, you will see no entry on the right-hand side.
Matthew, only in my addition to that, it's not Jane that would make the decision as to where the money goes. That's for Boston's ward councillors in our own patch. And specifically, if it's not something that's appropriate for the constituency committee, then you should raise that with the council, with the road safety team. So I'm just quite conscious that some of that was directed towards Jane, but actually Jane has the unenviable task of trying to manage the decision of the 15 councillors in the constituency, and she does very well, so I just wanted to make that note.
It's a good point well made, Matthew, so thank you for that. Anybody else want to say? I think you're
just a quickie. I travel there in the 3-4 times a week, and ultimately, you can get dead right of what you're saying, it's an absolute terrible law to come down. I asked 12, 18 months ago to our traffic department to see if we could do anything about it. Just small ideas, it should be stop HGVs coming down, because they all seem to take it as a short coming through. I'm not going to say anything about fire, but yes, you're definitely right. Should people coming in up and over the bridge from themselves automatically think the first right-hand turn is a two-way system, and they forget that it's that little road you're going to go past the next one. You're certainly correct in asking the name. It's something that I've realised as such. But over a period of time, that road is terrible. And as I say, I did ask them to check it out for me, and I got the figures back. I can't tell you what the figures were, but I couldn't believe the figures they came with, because it didn't represent what I knew was happening down there. So, Matthew, I'm quite correct in what he's saying.
Do you know the road on the Wirral is 30 miles an hour, whether the cars frequently going up to 60, 80 miles an hour?
Okay, I think it's a... So I think that's a good point well made. I'm hearing either side of me that people are making a note of that and we'll make sure it gets passable. And I think you also heard from Gerry in terms of the action that's ongoing with the board councillors and the traffic officers. So it seems to me we should get a good... I want to move on to a different...
Just very quickly, Gerry. Can I just say, as a point, can we invite the road safety manager to our next constituency forum meeting? Because this is a serious issue, and I think we've all, as ward councillors, I think we've all got issues in our ward. So it's just addressed to Jane, really. If we could have the road safety manager at our next meeting, so people, as well as ward councillors, people in the forum can ask questions directly to the Thanks, Chair. Thanks
for doing that. Okay, good stuff. Hopefully you have no extra stuff on them, possibly if they haven't, then I'll give you something to go out with. I saw it, here.
Thank you. I just want to pick up on the response to the other question about the weeds. A year ago in this meeting, we were Pensby, and the same question was raised there to David, who promised that he would sort something out about the weeds. And I'm sorry to bring it up tonight's level, but frankly, the response is totally inadequate. We've heard tonight a whole lot of gloss, a whole lot of projects, a whole lot of grot spots, but half of West Wirral is a grot spot because of the state of the curves, the roads, and the verges. Parts of Irby, the weeds are 3 foot high, parts of Pensby, Kenilworth, drive, for instance, you can't see the difference between the road and the curb. It's like one grass verge. So frankly, the response to the rolling programme is not adequate. It's been happening 3 years since the weeds were properly tackled. In my road in Irby, we've actually taken on the neighbours that are killing the weeds ourselves. One neighbour has even bought a bag of tarmac to repair the holes left in your road by your weeds.
Our road, by the way.
I didn't pay by council tax yet.
No,
it's
our road, of course.
Your responsibility.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. We talked to you about this time last year, and when I researched and I think very kindly followed that up with an email, that I think it was you that made some good suggestions about how it could be done. I passed all that on to the people who were responsible for that work, and they assured me that there were no issues, they were adequately resourced, they had adequate equipment, they had adequate trained people to ride the quad bikes, because that's been missing in previous years, because we trained them to ride the quad bikes and then they find more attractive than going on the back of that. I was told again this year that all the resources they needed were in place. But I agree with the comments you've made, and I will try to get that out.
It's not there.
No.
And it's now going to be dangerous.
Okay.
It's now going to be costing.
I'm going to be very fair, to try and get as many people to contribute as possible. Geoffrey.
Yeah, I just wanted to sort of endorse what Mr. Gardner has said, that there are plenty of places in Scurvy and Thurstaton Ward where the weeds and probably in Melsborough colleagues as well. I'm not sure what the other woods were, the weeds are now just as high as they were last year. And the thing you could really see is that, of course, the fact that the weeds were left, well, they were killed, that they died down on the spot and left and decayed into soil. This year's weeds are growing on fertile ground provided last year, and it's going to get worse and worse and worse as the years go by. Not only do they have to be prevented from growing to any size in the first place, but anything. The detritus left behind needs to be removed, and that just doesn't seem to be happening.
Well, again, because I'm honest. David.
Forgive my ignorance on the subject, but is it a slight false economy? I think it was either the last group or the group before where we had somebody talking about a flood. Is the greater the vegetation, the more likely to start to block the drains? Forgive me, because I'm a layman on this, but surely it's a false economy, and we don't want roads being flooded because the council doesn't address the, as our colleague said, 3 foot weeds. So I have to say that's a question I'm curious the answer for.
Yeah. Sorry, Mike. Yeah.
Yeah. Just to bring this debate a bit of reality to it, I had a lot of complaints last year in Pensby in my ward about weeds, and I got onto Parks and Gardens, and they came back to me and said, because of the cuts, there are teams short, so the programme for addressing the weeds, and it is going to get worse, it's not going to get any better. Mind you, we have been told that austerity is going to end, so it might help. But to bring this debate back to a bit of reality, it's because the Parks and Gardens are one team short because of the cuts. So the programme is being put further and further back. So, but it is, I agree, it is a very real issue. But it's an issue that the council, we as a council, are trying to address as best we can. Thanks,
well,
Chair.
I was going to try and give other people an opportunity too. But having some really good points been made, there does seem to be a bit of a tension between what David said, which was he had spoken to the people responsible. And have been reassured that we have all the staff they need, all the pop bikes they needed, and all that sort of stuff. To your assertion, which is clearly breaking up the love in, which I thought Andrew was keen to do. So in those terms, there is that dichotomy. So maybe at the next time we can actually get a resolution to this issue. Is it because they want to do it in a particular way at a particular time to get the most effect? Or is it because we're one team short? So we'll get that answer and we'll share it. And we'll share it across. Well, we'll talk about last year, we'll talk about this year. So let's just pick that up and make sure it's shared across all the members. You're waving a piece of paper.
Yeah, we'll just make five points. In terms of the Pensby.
That's pretty well everyone. Is that more to show you haven't done anything?
Thank you.
presentation, because it, but John came back with that particular session, as I recall. So, lots of things going on. The best thing to do is to have the proper officer concerned come back to us as a constituency committee and to make a factual presentation of where the process is and how it will be followed, rather than just trying to have a bit of a guess. So, Matthew has a suggestion.
Completely agree with you, Geoff. I think it's very important that the updates come here. And I just thought we both offer residents to be aware, but in a recent Cabinet SLT meeting, I did raise with relevant officers that because of negotiations and because this stuff does take quite a lot of time, I think it's really important that people don't think we're not hearing anything and stuff's probably happening without us knowing. It is just that there's not a delay, but it takes quite a lot of time to wrangle through negotiations. So I've asked specifically that they put in place proper community consultation, update events, because I think that's really important. So just I wanted everyone to be aware that that will be forthcoming, and I have requested that on a number of occasions. And as soon as they have an op, what they can't do is say, let's call one, everyone has loads of questions, and the answer is, we don't know because we're waiting for a report. So once they are in a position to be able to answer questions, I am very confident they'll be putting a number of meetings on.
Well, I'm sure we're all glad that you have you've done it. So I think oftentimes there's a vacuum, then all sorts of rumours and this and that. So I think the most important thing we have around this is the facts, what's happening, who's doing what, when, how, who, all that sort of stuff.
Can we agree then, Jeff?
Yeah.
Well, put it on the agenda.
Of the bottom of the road here.
Good question.
It's become a
drop spot for some time, and it's really bad at the moment. Is there any work being carried out, or is planning the application been submitted?
I can answer to you, Chair. I can answer that one in the sense that there has been a planning application approved some months ago, I can't give the exact date, for a housing development on that site. Now, of course, the question of whether it will actually be done is a matter for the owner of the site himself to promote it and take it further. He has 3 years from the date of the planning application approval to carry out any work at all on it. We have no indication at the moment through the planning process that he's about to start doing it. So the building, as it is at the moment, will continue in its present form. What we can try and do is to try and put some pressure onto the developer builder to do something there, but illegally we can't force him to do anything. What will happen is, if he doesn't do something within the 3 years period between granting a planning application and the time he starts doing it, the planning application will immediately lapse and he'd have to make another application. But there's no way the council at the present time can do anything to force him to do anything, I regret. But it's a good point, and I will certainly follow it on your behalf.
And I think the point that was made by Mike earlier was that if these places are turning into a crosswalk, then clearly we have the powers under the regulations that he's listed to actually take action and then force the owner of that property to pay for that, or I think that's the other point that was made, actually find a way of stopping any deterioration of the site by some other means rather than just allowing something to happen and making them pull on them and pick up the cost. But so there should be opportunity. We may have got a note here. Geoffrey.
Just briefly, I was driving past only a few days ago and noticed some men with a van on site because they're about to start to do something. So maybe they are preparing for it.
Probably
need
wood.
I walked past the scene here and I noticed they poured the windows in front of the
lab. Sorry. Go on, sir. Please make
it. Poured down the windows and work appears to have gone on in the grounds. So they are doing something, but it could stay.
I think what they're trying to do through you, Gerry, and I think they're trying to prevent it being vandalised any further by people breaking in and maybe knocking down in there for want of a better expression. But I have no information as to them doing any actual work on demolishing the existing building and replacing it with a housing development that has been approved.
All right. Thank you. Great question. And everyone who's on the way out, you know, you can have a quick look about the state of the place. Barbara.
Yes, I'm going to come back to my earlier comments about the contact details of one true organisation. Now then, helping when I was working for them, we tried to get a grant from the constituency committee, only to be told that they couldn't because helping deal with clients, people, isolated people, housebound people, over the whole world, so the grant wasn't couldn't be accepted. Now then, I'm thinking that why can't the four constituency committees agree a grant from each of them to helping because they serve the communities in the four constituencies? Because I think it is very bureaucratic, it's not transparent, and it isn't helping people who are isolated and need the care and attention from willing volunteers. This lady here, Tyrina, next door neighbour, has just finished as a volunteer. And I think that this is ridiculous in this day and age that some consensus couldn't come about whereby a grant of I don't know whatever money one needs to accept without individual applications going to the four constituencies. And I'm putting that forward as a proposal here, and I'm wondering if that is possible.
In terms of the four constituency areas, each constituency committee has identified priorities for its budget expenditure which differ from each other. But I do take the point is that there are things that happen across the world that are worldwide that actually there should be some adjusted approach to supporting if appropriate. So I'm more than happy to go have a further discussion, go away and talk to colleagues. Wirral has been the only committee, the only constituency area that has consistently had a grant
main link, but my understanding is we do have a worldwide grants programme.
This is something I have to defer to Jane on, but I certainly remember in previous years there was an opportunity for, was it Love Wirral?
It was Your Wirral.
Your Wirral,
which was money that the constituencies administered on behalf of Magenta. There was a worldwide grant, which I don't think that would have been into that, if my memory serves me, and for our monitor process for the four areas. Unfortunately, that money has now been spent, but absolutely go away now.
And I think the point is a sound one anyway, in terms of, as Matthew mentioned a little bit earlier, he's actually looking at how the council engages and involves volunteers, communities, local areas. So I think the point that you've made about seeing if there's something that can be done worldwide around some of this is an absolute, and I'm sure, you know, the two of you, I'm sure Matthew is listening. Very clearly.
I am.
Mike?
Could I just say, Chair, I'd like to support what Barbara said and help him. It's a tremendous charity. I volunteered for about 18 months there, and it's been one of the things they do is a luncheon club for the partially sighted and blind in Pensby. And the HelpLink is situated, its head office, or its only office, I think, is in Airby. So they have got a strong case from Wirral West Constituency Forum Fund. So I think when grants are being allocated in the future, Jane, if we could look, and I think this is what Barbara's asking for, if an application comes in from HelpLink, if we look more sympathetically at it in future. Thanks,
well,
Chair.
That is a little bit, and we have no problems with people coming in and making a pitch for that particular community. That's great, and my organisation is fantastic. We should do this, that, and the other thing, and that's fantastic. On the other hand, I'm sure there's a whole load of other community groups that equally do some good stuff, and we wouldn't want to favour anyone above it. It's the outcomes that they're going to deliver that is going to be the important thing.
Very quick points. I mentioned before the Verbo Bank Community Fund, which funds community initiatives of all kinds, and I think that is something that HelpLink should really look at, because it's a very regular deadline for quite large grants, which I'm more than happy to come talk to HelpLink about how that works.
And it's like everything, isn't it? I mean, you know, Jane and Helen are working through the years. The concourse and do a fantastic amount. Please don't wait until it's the constituency committee. I'm sure you're Melbourne. More than happy. I know you've got plenty on and all that, but you're always willing to do more, aren't you? It's the right answer. So please don't feel you have to wait until next week to say, we said this, nothing happened. You know, pop down in contact. Yeah. Okay.
Sorry, just to say very briefly, I think the Verbal Bank Community Fund and things like that are a stronger way to go forward. I cover two of these meetings out of four, and I go to the other two to cover them when I need to, and they all work in very different ways. This one is unique in the way you allocate your money, and you get the kind of results that you've seen tonight. It would be pretty hard to get them all on the same page, particularly when the grant is suspended for this year. So I think probably the bigger grants coming in like that one would be a better place to contribute.
I mean, that's a really, really good point, actually. So, did I see? Oh, okay, my sister.
Any member of this committee can be elected as chair, and it could be one of your community members. members of the audience might like sort of the club to some of the information that I got back. So thank you for that, Joe.
Free stuff over there. What they do over the election. Free stuff is very welcome.